I will also like over here, I will also like to welcome the audience joining us at on Facebook Live. So thanks a lot for joining us today for our workshop. And over here, I would like to thanks all. I will write. Okay. Over here, I will also like to thank you and acknowledge our program funder, IRCC, Immigration, Refugees and Citizenship Canada. And without their support, we won't be able to present these workshops and services. And I would like to acknowledge their support. And before we start, few house rules for the webinars today. Number one, please keep your microphone on mute so it won't disturb the presenter. Number two, please keep your cameras turned off because we are going live on Facebook. So we will really appreciate if you can keep it off. No abusive language will be tolerated, obviously. And please do not post any personal information in the chat box. And we encourage you all for the questions. Whatever the question you have, utilize this opportunity to ask the question from the presenter. So hold on to your questions. And in the end, you can always ask these questions in the chat box. Okay. And last but not the least, evaluation. So evaluation link will be sent out at the end of workshop, and we appreciate your feedback to ensure the better quality workshop. So
I just want to add one thing here. There's a lot of people who have joined in either without a name or with a different name than they registered as. If you could please either put your name that you registered as on your screen, you can click on the three dots and put your name. Or you can just message me and I will make sure that you get the attendance, because we'll be sharing some resources after the workshop and we will not be able to share it with you if this is the thing. Okay, go ahead, Nabil.
Okay, thanks a lot, everyone. So my name is Nabil Vayani. I'm a newcomer employment specialist with Immigrant Services Calgary. And today's topic for our webinar today is Canadian workplace culture and expectation, and it will help you to understand the values and expectation at work. Our presenter today for this topic is Gaurav Nagpal. Gaurav is immigrant himself, and he worked in the past as a career coach, and he has experience dealing with immigrants. And he knows what the challenges newcomers face at the workplace, and he have information and insight to share with all of us. So Gaurav, first of all, thanks a lot for joining us today and taking time out. I know you're really busy these days, and thanks a lot for joining us. And without wasting any time, over to you guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nabil, and thank you so much, Meenakshi, for having me here for the presentation. I hope everybody can hear me. So my name is Gaurav, as Nabil just gave a brief introduction. I moved here with my family in year 2011. I initially moved to Winnipeg, which is Manitoba. We also call it Winterbeg. And after, you know, working there for like 4.5 years or so, then I decided to move to Calgary for, you know, future growth. And now we are here for 6.5 years plus. And at present, I am working as a real estate agent in Calgary. And before that, I was, as just Nabil mentioned, throughout my, I think I will say good 8-9 years, I was working as a career coach, where I have helped almost, if I'm not wrong, maybe 4,000 to 5,000 immigrants in getting to the job market. In Calgary alone, I think I've helped over 3,000 immigrants getting into the job market. So that is my kind of little profile here.
Sorry, one minute, Gaurav. Maria, could you please turn off your camera because you're showing on Facebook Live? Thank you.
All right. So let's begin with, you know, why we are here today. We are here today because I know, I understand that people here might be, you know, arrived just, you know, maybe under 1 year, or maybe they're here for 2 years, 3 years. Some of you got the job. Some of you are still looking for jobs. And some of you are still wondering, why am I not getting a call? I am the perfect candidate for this job. Whatever they have written, I qualify for that, but I haven't even received a call. Okay, so before I go into that, let me...
Sorry, Gaurav, you are on mute.
Hi, my name is Farha. Hello?
Ma'am, please mute yourself and turn off your camera. The presentation is on. Please mute during the presentation.
Yeah, I just did mute.
So mute and turn off your cameras. Everybody, please turn off your cameras and please mute your microphones.
I'm not sure how I got muted. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I have no idea how I got muted because I never even touched the laptop. So that's something interesting. Something to learn, immigrants. No, just kidding. Okay. So what I was saying is that before I go into and launch into that topic, what I want to make sure and to tell about is communication. The number one thing in Canada when you are here is communication. And by communication, I have no meaning of, you know, language skills or anything related to that. When I say communication, I mean you should go out, talk to people. This is also called networking, but it is first of all a communication because we always get afraid of a no. We always think that if we want help or if we can ask for help, there might be a no. But in my opinion, in my experience of 11 years here in Canada, I think if you will ask for help, people are ready to help. I'm not saying everybody will help you, but what I'm saying is there are people who understand you. There are people who have been successful in the past take my example. You know, I've been here for 11 years. If somebody texts me, I'm ready to help them. Still, I'm ready to help them because I enjoy helping them because I feel sense of achievement. I feel that, you know, I'm helping somebody like me who is struggling right now in that phase because I went through that phase. So I understand what you might be going through. Now, let me also say, if you might have any questions, we will have a time in the later part where you can ask me questions. And I you know, promise I will try my best to answer them. All right. So coming back to communication, what kind of communication is required? One, you go, don't apply online for jobs. You go in person to the companies. I understand it's a COVID situation. You know, not many employers might be, you know, okay in getting you in, but you can always go on LinkedIn and try your best to approach people, as many as you can. Try to find people who you want to become, which means, let's say if you want to become an accountant, you want to become a pharmacist, you try finding 3 or 4 good profiles. And first of all, see their growth, see where they started here, which kind of education they got, what kind of experience they got. And then with that help, you can, you know, send them a personalized message by saying that, you know, you are a new immigrant and why you're here is you're looking for some help. Don't ask for jobs. People will run away from you. I'm telling you upfront, people will run away from you if you ask for jobs. Just say, hey, I'm a newcomer. I'm just, you know, approaching you to get some help, to get some insight of a professional in my field. Is that okay if I can connect with you over a coffee in Tim's in downtown? And that way I can just bring in my resume and you can review it and let me know how to proceed here, how to get into my field here. I'm telling you, it is way better than any coach like me also when I was, who was in, you know, generic in a sense that I wanted to help everybody for common issues. But when you connect with a professional who is in your field, will help you in understanding the market, the industry, and also might give you the ways to get in. And sometimes, don't be afraid of only finding those people who are in your profession. Why? Because you don't know whom they know. In Canada, it doesn't matter who you know. What matters is who they know. So for example, let's say I'm in real estate. Now you approach me and you say, you know, I'm a newcomer, blah, blah, blah. Who knows if my relative is a pharmacist or my relative is an accountant? I'll say, hey, you know what? He's looking for a person who, you know, who has less experience to start with. Let me connect you. So don't get afraid. That is number one. Now, the other thing we struggle is when we get into the job market and why we struggle. So let's say you get into a job market and your supervisor comes to you at job and say, okay, do this. And now, because you're in a very beginning stage, you might miss some things because you're not used to your ears are not used to that fast language. As we speak our local language, they might not understand at all. So, but what generally I have noticed, I have experienced in the past, is people just nod their head like that and say, yeah, you understood? Yep, perfect. After 2 hours, when the supervisor follows up with you and you have not done the work which they were expecting, that's the time when they get upset with you. That is the time when they feel that you are maybe incompetent. So, but the picture, the scenario is different. Maybe what we do is we just out of respect say yes, or we kind of get scared to ask questions. That is wrong. Ask questions as much as possible. If you are not understanding in one way, say, can you rephrase the question for me? Or can you rephrase what you have just said to me? That way, they understand that they have to tell you to take out the work from you. So at the end of the day, what they want from you is work. They don't want you to, you know, say at the end, oh, sorry, I didn't understand that. That's what they will not pay you for, unfortunately. So that is one of the common mistakes I have noticed throughout my 8-9 years of career. Now, the other things which you have to, you know, consider, and again, I'm on the topic of communication, which is kind of a silent communication, you can call it, or indirect communication, is the body language. You have to read the body language of the person you're talking to. Now, as an example, you go for an interview, right? And most of the time, people who can relate, I'm not sure how many are on Facebook or in the session, but from in certain countries, especially in my country, it is out of respect that we do not have a proper eye contact with everybody. So let's say in this case, you are in the interview and you're not making an eye contact with the person, the HR person. Here, again, it's a cultural difference. So in their culture, they believe that if you are not having an eye-to-eye connection while talking, you are not confident of what you're saying, or you're making up things. You might be surprised with that. I can give you a very quick example. One time I kind of placed one student of mine into the company, and they went for the interview. The HR called me after the interview and said, we cannot hire her because, you know, she might be lying or she might be making up things throughout the interview. When I kind of dig more into that, this is exactly what I told you was happening. They were like, she was out of respect, not having an eye contact, and almost lost the opportunity. But I jumped in, I explained them the cultural differences. I let them understand. And I also let them understand that on your end, you have to also take diversity and inclusion course, because that will help you to understand different cultures, where they're coming from, and why they're not doing that. There might be a certain reason for that. I'm not saying everybody do it for a reason, but there are some people who might be doing it purposely. But 95% of new immigrants, they want job. Why they will do that? So that is what they have to understand. But this is also what we have to understand. And another thing is the body language. So if you're talking to a person and if they're really getting, you know, upset, but they're so soft spoken here and they're so polite that they might not tell you that, which is very nice of them that they don't want to hurt your feelings. So in that case, what you have to do is you have to read their body language and go accordingly. It is kind of a prompt action which you have to take at that point of time. All right. Now, the next thing in my experience is networking. I'm not sure how many of you guys have already started, you know, working on networking, or heard so many times, you know, from people that networking is important here, networking, go for networking, do networking, because that is how this country runs. It runs on who knows whom. There are still in this market also 60% jobs which get filled just by referencing, not by advertising. It might be a blown out number in even COVID times, but that is the reality. 60% jobs you will not even see on Indeed.com. You will not, because they are getting hired directly by the referral. And that referral is not nothing like an approach to somebody or, you know, giving a favor to somebody. What networking here means is simply, yes, you want a person. I have a person. He is good or she is good. Go interview. If they like it, they'll hire you. But without advertising in the labor marketplace. So that is 60%. So whatever you see online is 40%. Now, if I reverse it 10 years back, still people have a lot of struggles with when you go for interview, you've been told that you don't have Canadian experience. And for me, I was like, it happened with me. And I was like, okay, in what senses I should have a Canadian experience when I moved as an immigrant here? Like, I cannot have work experience, which is Canadian. So a lot of people then get upset and think about what Canadian experience should I get if I don't get a job? But by Canadian experience, what they mean, they understand is that, okay, we don't know you. You came to our country. We don't know you. We don't know your culture. We don't know your personality. We don't know how you work. So that is Canadian workplace culture for them. So how to eliminate that negativity is to start doing volunteer work. Go talk to people, do volunteer work. When you go and do volunteer work, you will meet those people. You will show your skill set. You will make connections. You will talk to them. You will show them your behavior. You will show that you're punctual. You know, that is what they are afraid of when they say you don't have Canadian work experience. And you might have, or some of you might have already noticed that when you go and do the volunteer work and then go and apply for a job, you will get a call because they have somebody in Calgary, in this case, in this city, to talk to somebody about you and ask them, how are you doing there? So that is another thing which is majorly missing even nowadays, that people don't do networking, or they don't talk to each other about these things. But this is the reality, and I think it is going to stay the Canadian experience. But saying that, I have also noticed that last 3 years, the pattern is changing. And why it is changing? Because they have started recognizing the work experience you have back home. And especially in case of IT jobs, in case of engineering jobs, banking jobs, admin jobs, because the skill set which you require is still common. It doesn't change with the country you move into. You still need to be having a smiling face. You still need to be friendly. You still need to be customer oriented. You know, those things will never change in whatever job you go. So at least now I have noticed the pattern where they have started recognizing it, but still there are people who still believe that if you have no experience, they might not consider you over the other person. But as I said, it all depends in the market demand and supply. The economics comes to play. If there is demand, they don't care. They sometimes hire you right away. You might have noticed, again, I don't know how many of you got that. So maybe I'll love to hear back, after I'm done with my session, that if you got the job without experience, or maybe 1 week after, you're arriving in the city, you might be lucky. Now that is one. And the other topic which Nabil also mentioned here is more about the distribution of responsibilities is kind of he mentioned here. So what that means? It means that when we go into the workplace, new workplace, we try to show that how efficient we are. We try to do our best to prove ourselves we are the best. I'll give you an example. An example is this, and I did it myself. So let take me as an example here. My supervisor came to me. I was 1 month into the job, and I was full day busy with taking clients. And my boss came. He said, can you take 6 more people? We are already closed, so you might have to go late. And I was like, perfect, I will take it. Because I thought, you know, I'm making an impression that I'm the hard worker, you know, I'm the best. And I did it. And what happened? I was tired. I kind of delayed in what I was supposed to do in 15 minutes. I was doing in 30 minutes. But at the same time, I made some data entries which were wrong because I was tired. Now, over the time, what I learned from my experience and from many other immigrants I helped is that you have to understand that you can do whatever you can do up to your capacity. In all good sense, in all positive sense, you can only do, but you have your limits. Your mind, your brain gets tired. It has in its own limits. So after that, what is next step? How to solve that problem? So how to solve that problem is with 2 different ways. One way is you have to start prioritizing your stuff. You have to understand what is the priority for me right now. Is it my work-life balance? Is it, and let's say if we are only focusing on work here, then let's say what kind of work I can leave right now for the next day or the next day based on my priorities. Or if everything is a priority at this point of time, whatever you're doing, what will you do when your supervisor will come and say, can you take this and you want to create an impression? Again, communication. You have to communicate with your supervisor. They don't mind it. Just say that, you know, I am busy with this stuff, which is also of a priority, which I have to deliver by end of the day. So how about this, if we can delegate the authority? How about this, if I can split the work, I can take 2 clients out of 6. How about if you find 2 more people who can take 2 each? And that way, you know, you're delegating the responsibility. And that way you do your work, plus you have not kind of pissed off your supervisor. Still, you have shown your communication skills. Still, you have shown your priorities to the supervisor and how serious you are with them. And also, you have shown that you have the skill set to delegate and to give ideas, because they want people here who can take initiative. That is number 1 priority of any employer. It is more like if you are in a workplace culture, and somebody is coming to you every time that, oh, what do you think about it? And you are saying, oh, well, you know, it's whatever you said is fine. They don't appreciate it. But if you have your ideas, if you have your creativity going on, they would love to hear that from you. Although it can be wrong, although they might not take it, but that is not the purpose. The purpose is not ego. The purpose is to prove them that you can take initiatives. The idea is that you are also creative and you have your own ideas you come up with. And you know, regarding the sometimes, you know, in interviews also, they, you know, ask you these scenario-based questions and people struggle to answer them because what they are looking for in these questions is the initiative you have taken to solve the problem. So that way, you know, in even this one scenario, you have proven them 2 to 3 different skill sets. One is communication. One is sense of responsibility. 3, you're not afraid of taking more work. 4, that you prioritize the stuff. And 5, that you are concerned with the mutual benefit of the company you are working for. So you care for them. But at the same time, you're also telling them, hey, I'm in Canada. Work-life balance is also important. So after this, I have to go home. I understand there are situations where you might have to stay back, but they don't encourage here you to stay longer because they understand the work-life balance. So it is totally fine to do that. All right. Another example I would like to give you of the culture. I don't want to name anybody, but there was a student. We placed in a company and she was doing all fine, all good. one day this company owners, like couple of the, I think there were two partners, and then the rest of the staff, they said, hey, come on, you know, we are going to the pantry and we are having beer in the evening. And she said, no, I'm not going there. No, I don't drink, I have to work. And she kept working for at least 2 hours until they finished their party. And that was after work at 5 p.m. on Friday. Now, next day, I received a call from this owner of the company. And he said, you know, we were trying to hire this client permanently because she was on placement. But now we have some challenges because she is not social. And I understood the situation from them. I try to, you know, grasp what is happening here in the back end, you know, and then I thought, okay, this is trouble for her. So I went to her, I spoke to her. I said, where it went wrong? Why you did that? Was that a special thing? And she said, no, you know what? In my culture, we don't drink. And that is why I decided to just not even go there. Now, I'm not sure if that is the right way to do. But what I explained to her at that point of time is that the purpose is not to drink beer. The purpose is to socialize. The purpose is to network out of your office thing hours with the staff members, because they think you're not friendly. They think you're not responsive. They think you're not gelling, you know, together with each other. So that is the impression they got. And I can tell you this, they can hire a person who has less technical skills, but having more soft skills, rather than a person who is 100% good on technical skills, but lacking soft skills, because they know that they cannot teach somebody to how to smile. They cannot teach somebody how to mingle with each other. They cannot teach you how to be friendly, but they can teach you a software. They can teach you how to excel to go to the next position in the company. So the target for them is your overall personality, not only your technical skills. So in case if somebody is still, you know, struggling to get a job and having excellent skills, just try to focus on soft skills as well. Just try to be there. And in all this bigger picture, in bigger, scheme of things, I understand that still, if you have all the skills, you will say, Gaurav, I have soft skills, I have technical skills, I went to you know, places to meet in person, still I'm not getting where I want to be. Then I will say, have patience. Things will come. They don't come and don't rush. They come with the time. They come maybe 2 years from down the road. They come 3 years down the road, but they don't come when you expect them to come. It is like a kid going to a school in grade one and say, why I'm not learning science? So science will come, but when she goes to grade 10 or he goes to grade 10, it will come. So similarly, things will happen. You will get promotion. You will get, you know, up in the company. You will get higher packages, but everything happens with time frame. So you have to have your long-term goals and make sure that your short-term goals are not a hindrance in reaching to your long-term goals. And by that, I'll give you an example. If you have to go to Northwest, and if you start driving towards Southwest, you will never reach Northwest. So in your short-term goals, you have to make sure, you have to understand with the help of the coaches or the mentors that you are on the right track. So as an example, if you want to become an accountant, I don't want you to keep working in 7-Eleven or McDonald's and expect you will become an accountant one day. Maybe you can become an administrator in an accounting firm or any other firm where, you know, there is some accounting related work happens. That is what I call walking on the path to achieve your long-term goals. So this is very, very important in present time. And I understand, you know, in COVID times, it was a very, very tough time for everybody. It's not only you who might have, you know, experienced that, but there are several thousands, hundreds and thousands of people who have experienced the same thing. People are getting frustrated. People are getting upset. People are thinking why we made the decision to come here, which generally happens in first 2 years. Doesn't matter. I have not seen a person who have not told me that, including myself. I tried to move back three times in first 6 months. You know, we ever said, oh, you know what, we have everything. Why I moved here? Why the cold weather? You know, everything. But then eventually you have to understand that you were the ones who made the decision to come here. And when you made the decision to come here, there must be something which prompted you to do that. So find that cause. Find why were you here? Were you here for kids? Were you here for your future betterment? There might be a reason why you moved. So if you moved and made that big, big decision in your life, which is the hardest decision to make, which is the courageous decision to make, then don't be afraid when you already arrived here. Then you are just steps away from your success. You can be successful. Everybody can be successful in their fields. It's just a matter of time, but also the efforts, the amount of effort, the time you spent in making that efforts is what counts at the end of the day. If you are not talking to a new person in Canada, you are not doing your homework. I'm telling you upfront, it is the most important thing in Canada. Try to talk to a new person. It can be a chatting, it can be, you know, LinkedIn, it can be you. Okay, so let's say we all are, you know, targeting the job market, and we are all after LinkedIn and, you know, asking people about jobs or, you know, refer me somewhere. But there is another aspect of it where you can find ways to still connect with people without doing that. What is that? It is like joining something. I'm not sure if everybody heard about like meetup groups. So there's a website called meetup.com. So you go there, you find your interest. For example, I personally referred somebody, you know, in a similar way I'm telling you. And that person joined the group, which was for hiking. And in hiking group, you know, he started talking, and, you know, that group, you know, decided to go to Banff or wherever, Canmore, for a hiking. Guess what? This guy was a geologist in oil and gas industry, of course. And the person he was doing hiking with was a vice president in oil and gas company. And they kind of chatted around while hiking, and they connected. And right now he's in one of the top positions in that company. And there are so many other examples I can give you, because I have a span of 8-9 years. But I don't want to kind of end up in talking, you know, the same thing again and again, but rather I want to give you information which is kind of on different topics as of now. So the next topic which I would like to touch base upon is, let me see here what Nabil says so that I can relate it to. Feedback. Okay, that's a good point. Feedback. Now, I'm sure that some of you might have experienced that they do the employee review here. And I'll give you an example. So one time, an employee of mine, actually, like we were colleagues, and our supervisor called somebody in and gave the feedback. So the feedback was like this. Oh, you're doing great. We're liking, you know, what you do. You come on time, and, you know, you spend time, and you're professional, you're friendly. Maybe, you know, consider, you know, taking some courses about, you know, the Toastmasters for communication skills. Maybe, you know, consider, you know, leaving 5 minutes late than what you do. And then, but overall, we are very happy with you. Good luck. Now, this employee came back and was the happiest person I've ever seen in my entire life. And I was like, what happened? Hey, it's like, I'm just like, it was my 3-month review. I'm on probation. They like love me. I think my supervisor is falling in love with me. Like, absolutely nothing wrong. I'm doing perfect. And I said, hold on. Yes, it's a sandwich approach. So they told you in the beginning a very good thing to make you positive, to feel about positive about yourself. At the end, they finished, but it is a sandwich. You have to understand what came in between. So maybe, could be, should be, you could, you know, you would listen to those. listen to those. Those are the, that is the feedback. That is the real feedback you'll ever get from your employer, because they're soft-spoken. They don't want to hurt your feelings at all. So that is where they say, maybe take this course. Toastmasters, have you ever thought of Toastmasters? Why are they saying that? Because they feel that you lack a little bit of communication skills. You lack public skills. So public speaking is important in any workplace culture. So they are suggesting you to take Toastmasters, but they are not suggesting you. They are actually advising you, but by using a word maybe. But they are saying, take it. Take this. You know, you could leave 5 minutes after, or take, let's say, and as an example, consider taking, 5 minutes shorter lunch break some days. So they're telling you that you're always 5 or 10 minutes over the lunchtime. So please listen to those. Don't feel happy if they have not told you anything, but I'm telling you that this is something which is a feedback from them, which you have to grasp it and understand it. And if you haven't understood anything from the feedback, let's say, or you feel everything, how can everything is so good about me? They have not even mentioned one thing. Ask to them. Again, communication, ask. Say, hey, just wondering, thank you, thank you very much for the feedback. But may I ask you, is there anything you want me to improve upon, or I can improve upon to excel in the company or to move on to the next position? Maybe then they will tell you directly that, how about, have you read this, or have you did this, right? Have you registered here? So that way also, that's another way of asking things to your supervisors to move up the ladder. Plus also they get happy that you understand that you need work to be done upon you, and also that you are taking the initiative of asking, which means you are serious. You are interested in your career, you are serious in your career, and you really want to excel in your life. So consider all those things. All right, let's move on to the last topic, and then we will, I promise we'll take the questions. So, well, actually I covered, it says networking and more, but I think networking, I have said enough to you about networking, that now I can tell you a little bit about how to dig more into the networking. I understand that there might be networking events where people were coming, but there is another kind of networking. The networking is, let's say on LinkedIn, you go into the advanced search option and try to find not only people from your country, but people who were graduated from the same university, college you did back home. Try to find people from the same high school you pass, because that doesn't matter if they're senior to you, they were junior to you. I can tell you, if you come to me and say, hey, I'm from India, I will be like, okay. But if you come to me and say, hey, I'm from North Campus in, University of Delhi, and I was also part of this college from this to this, I will relate with you right away, because I don't know, it's a human nature or something, but psychologically, I will be like, I should help this guy. He is from my university, or he's from my college. He knows my teachers. Connect on that level with them. Connect on the personal level. Don't pressurize them for job. Don't say, give me a job. Say, hey, it was wonderful to see somebody from my, back home who, went to the same university or whatever. And then say, let's catch up and, on a coffee thing. And then say those things, and then bring your resume and say, do you know if you know somebody who can help me with this? Because that necessarily not be the person who belongs to your profession, but they belong to your university, they belong to your country, they belong to your school, they belong to your, common religious place where you go to, right, back home. So those things you have to find out of on your own. Nobody, I'm telling you, will come and say, do this. And they do for you. They don't. You have to put the efforts. You have to make the efforts to make everything possible. I understand that again, that I'm saying that again and again, that these were the tough times. The last 2 years were horrible for some people. And I do respect that, you're still here attending the session. You're trying to understand what is going on. But I'm telling you, some things never change. And that what thing never change is that happiness is in our hand. The positivity, the being positive, you know, staying positive is in our hands. Negativity, you know, if we have to spread, it will be spread in like a fire, maybe faster than that, maybe. But to remain positive, to remain internally motivated, I use this word specifically internally, because nobody can motivate you, your coach, your family members, your children, they cannot motivate you until you have the motivation internally within. If you have that, you can do anything you want in the world. But if you don't have internal motivation, doesn't matter who comes to you and say, hey, I have this, let's do that, let's put effort, you will not, because you're not internally motivated. So my best advice to you is be motivated, be positive, and try your best, put your efforts. I promise the results will come. They will. There is no case I've ever heard, I've ever seen in my last 11 years in Canada, where people are not getting successful after making an effort. See, understand my point. I left my job. I designed my job because I wanted to do real estate. And I know there were 5,500 other, you know, agents there. But I can very proudly say with my efforts, I'm doing really good. So that is something you have to consider, that efforts count at the end of the day. So on that note, I will open up to Meenakshi and see if, you know, she can open up for the questions.
Thank you, Gaurav, for the presentation. So we'll say bye to our Facebook Live audience from here, because we'll be taking questions, and then let me just stop the live stream. And bye-bye, Facebook Live audience.